The Beast.
And here we go, ladies and gentlemen, Eddie the Beast.
Oh. I knew in my mind I am the strongest man on the planet.
We have a new British champion.
You don't see me on that number one spot. I will die trying.
Unbelievable.
You can do amazing things. You can achieve anything. I'm living proof of that.
The 500 kilo is going to fall.
It's going to be me that's going to do it.
500 kilograms is no longer a myth.
Will's strongest man is mine. I'm winning that title.
He's going to win it. And he does.
The world's strongest man. Right here. Eddie Hall. The greatest surf athlete there has ever been.
Bring the action.
Eddie Hall! Hi there.
Hi there.
I love that you bring Wolf with you wherever you go. Such a good dog.
He is. Yeah. He's great.
How are you doing?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Yeah, good. I haven't seen you since last year. Has it been interesting 12 months?
Yeah.
Tell me a bit of this.
It has, yeah. It's pretty interesting.
Seen that you've been a bit busy at the start of the year as well?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been good. Anyway, it's lovely to see you. Lots of people here to listen to a chat with you. And I just thought, I had a little look at your website and I love the description where you kind of say that you've gone from, what is it you've actually said, your truck mechanic to superstar. That's it. But that is essentially.
Did I say that?
It's on your website.
Well, I don't like to call myself a superstar, but maybe truck mechanic to Will's strongest man. I don't know about superstar.
I mean, it's amazing though. You've travelled around the world. You've got so many amazing records as well. Do you put this? Do you credit it all down to dedication, commitment, and focus?
It's all of those things. It's turning up every day and being obsessed. It's sacrificing. It's dedication. It's, you know, to be the best in the world at anything, you've got to be absolutely military dedicated to it. And that's something I'm very good at, is when I set my mind to something, is attacking it.
Yeah, I think that's the thing. A lot of people, they see the goals that they would like to achieve, but they're just not willing to put in that hard work. But you have really worked hard.
100%. I think a lot of it is putting pressure on yourself. You know, I was very vocal, you know, just starting out strongman. My very first strongman competition when I was 19, I said on social media, I'm going to win the world's strongest man one day. And that was when I was 19 years old. So I suppose putting the pressure on yourself makes you do those things. You know, it's sort of like backing up your bullshit, as they say. And that's something that I like to put pressure on myself because it makes me achieve those things.
Yeah. So 19 it was that you started winning and started taking part in all these amazing competitions. You've spent 15 years kind of at the top there. Now, 34, am I right in saying that?
34.
So old. Are you at your peak, past your peak, still to peak? How does it work?
In terms of strongman?
Yeah.
I think I'm well past my peak. I think the human body peaks strength-wise at about 30 years of age. So anything after that, you're sort of really struggling to keep up with the younger generation. You know, I would say mid-20s to sort of late 20s is the peak time for a human body to sort of, you know, be the best for strength.
Yeah. When you started training, what was the catalyst that made you go, right, strength, that's for me? Because, I mean, we know that you've been swimming before that and you could have been, like, top of your game there, but suddenly it was strong man that you wanted to kind of focus on.
I think strong man is something that's always been sort of like a fixation for me from a very young age. I remember watching Will's Strongest Man on TV when I was about 5, and I remember watching it and just being mesmerised. And I remember looking around the room and seeing my mum, my dad, my brothers, all the jaws on the floor, watching these massive guys pull planes, lift Atlas stones, lift these ridiculous weights. And I think for me, that was like a subconscious like tick. Like, I want to be that guy. I want to be the guy that makes people's jaw drop on the floor, you know, leave people flabbergasted and sort of, wow. And that's, as a young boy, that's what you sort of get you know, you sort of get like fixated on, you know, you get a goal very young and that's all right, it sort of sticks in the back of your mind forever.
Yeah, I mean, I watched all those, I was obsessed as well, and it's amazing when you see you walking along with a plane being pulled behind you. Does that ever come in handy in normal life? Do you ever go, I need the car moved, can't find the keys, let's just push it?
There's been some instances, yeah, where I've had to, yeah, there I've had to push trucks and cars and stuff. And I used to be a truck mechanic. I was a truck mechanic for 10 years. And there were so many times where somebody couldn't lift a gearbox or an engine or, you know, like a brake caliper or undo a bolt. And they'd be like, Eddie, come and do this. So, you know, I was sort of like the workhorse in the garage where I was a mechanic.
Oh my God, it's amazing. It is amazing. But the work ethic, kind of in terms of training, because I guess you see training as a job then when you're doing something like this?
100%, it is a job. I was working, I started work at 16 as a truck mechanic and I did that up until I was 26. And I trained all through that, you know, I was training 20 hours a week all that time. And then at 26, I sort of got my big break and got, you know, got some good sponsors on board, got a good manager, and I quit the job. And then my strongman, even though I was doing the same hours of training, that became my full-time profession. But what the difference is I was getting up every day and every living, waking moment was dedicated to strongman. You know, I was like, as soon as I woke up, I was like, right, I need to fuel, get some fuel in, ready for the training session later today. And then I need to go back to bed. I need to fuel, I need to do physio, I need to go for a walk, I need to stretch. It was like the whole day was dedicated to strongman. And when you add up all the hours, pretty much from 7 in the morning till midnight, you're probably talking, I was doing the hours of probably 2.5-3 full-time jobs, you know, so it was a lot, and that's 7 days a week. It was a very hard task.
Yeah. And the Beast, how did the Beast become the name?
So the Beast came about in 2015 when I flew to Australia for the Arnold Classic Australia, and I was asked to do a world record deadlift. 11 a.m. in the morning, after a week of competing, just got off a 24-hour flight, and I was asked to pull this world record deadlift in front of Arnold Schwarzenegger, which I did, and then Arnold, when I did the lift, he's like, oh, he's a beast, he's amazing, oh yeah. So Arnold just like proper praised me on the, you know, on the TV channels and everything else, and all the headlines wasn't Eddie Hall breaks world deadlift record, it was the Beast breaks the world deadlift record. And that's where it came from. So because Arnold Schwarzenegger called me the Beast, that's where it just stuck. Everyone knew me as the Beast, so I just sort of grabbed it with two hands and incorporated it into my brand really, and it paid off.
Yeah, the brand is strong. I mean, what have we got? Who takes the protein? Who, anyone do that? Who's got the sauces? There's so much.
Everyone's a bit embarrassed to put their hand up, but yeah, there's like there's t-shirts, there's food,
everything.
There's protein.
I've heard there's even duvet covers.
I think there was a, yeah, I don't sell them, but there are people that have got duvet covers.
Don't have one?
No.
Just checking. So hang on, you've got the Beast and you have this incredible work ethic and you train hard, and then you're also a dad and a husband as well. So are you two different people?
100%, you know, you've got to be. You've got to have a sort of like a TV persona, almost. And I think, you know, people sort of get this misconception. It's like the baddie out of EastEnders, you know. People sort of get mixed up between the two. You'll see the guy out of EastEnders that's beat somebody up or done something nasty and they get shouted out in the street. And I think having those two personas is a very important thing, because you've got to put that persona on when you're on the stage, you know, when you're competing in front of thousands of people, and you've got to entertain, because at the end of the day, strongman is an entertainment sport, that's it. You date it back to like the early centuries, it was a strongman circus act. It's an entertainment sport. It always has been, always will be. It's an entertainment. So I realised that very early on, that you've got to shout, you've got to bawl, you've got to be arrogant, you know, you've got to get the eyes on you, and as long as you back it up, that's what makes it entertaining. And then of course, when I'm home, you know, I'm dad, I'm Eddie the husband, I'm Uncle Ed, you know, and I
love that. So do you do all the normal things? Do you empty the dishwasher? Do you clean the toilet? Do you do the washing?
I mean, my wife will disagree, but my wife does absolutely everything at home. But I clean up after myself quite good, don't I, babe? Like, I'll at least put my clothes in the washing basket, and I'll probably put my plates on top of the dishwasher.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So there's small steps.
Yeah,
baby steps.
Okay. Do them a bit, yeah.
What kind of man are you when you're not the beast?
I'm very chill, very relaxed. I sort of, you know, I like to do things like normal people. I like to watch TV, I like to play video games, I like to paint, I like to walk my dog. You know, I like spending time with my son. I just do normal things. So, yeah. I always say this, right? It doesn't matter what I've done. Like, winning the World's Strongest Man is great, and people might see me as a star or a celebrity or whatever. But I always say, excuse the language, but I always say this to everybody: is I have to sit down and take a shit, like everybody else. I'm no better than everybody else, and I realise that. And I think after winning the World's Strongest Man, you get this huge high. Like, you're winning the World's Strongest Man, you feel on top of the world, you feel like you feel invincible, you feel like you can run through brick walls. And 2 days later, I'm wiping my son's arse, I'm doing the dishes, I'm, you know, what? but I'm doing normal things, and I think that's... I didn't realise that until I won the World's Strongest Man, that it doesn't matter. You know, you're a normal human being, and you've got to come back down to earth. And I think for some people, and it was hard for me, once you've had that huge high, coming back down to earth is quite tough. You know, doing those normal things, because you think that high is going to last forever. It's like a drug. Once you've had that first hit of the drug, you get this amazing feeling, and that's when people get addicted, is because they keep doing the drug, trying to get that high, trying to get it higher and higher. And that's like winning the World's Strongest Man, but unfortunately, you can't have that high every day. So, you know, coming back down to reality was quite tough. And it's been well documented that Olympic gold medalists and world champions get these huge highs, you know, on top of the planet, and then the next day, they're back down to reality. And that's quite tough for people, and people get depressed, and I'm a victim of that. You know, it's a tough thing to go through, to have that huge high and come back down and face reality, really.
I do think that happens with a lot of sports stars and actors, Hollywood stars as well. There are well-documented issues with mental health as well. And yeah, for that reason, what do you do when you go to a dark place? Because you've had experiences of this even before you were a strongman too.
Yeah, I mean, I'm quite open about it. I suffered anxiety and depression in my younger years. And then I've had it through my adulthood, but you know, I deal with it because I have to take a step back and see my self-worth. And my self-worth is what I'm worth to my family. You know, I'm a husband, I'm a dad, I'm an uncle, I'm a son. And I see those important things, and that's what keeps me grounded and what keeps me moving forward. And I suppose with those people around me, it's having that sort of support network. And if you've got that in place, you can pretty much get through anything.
Yeah, absolutely. I love the fact that wherever you go, people are inspired by you. Why? I presume that's something that you want to do as well. You want to inspire people. Why is that important?
I mean, inspiring people is you need, I don't want to sound big-headed, but you need people like myself to go out and do these amazing things to inspire the younger generation. You know, the first man on the moon, you've got Elon Musk. I mean, you know, he invented the Tesla. Sounds daft, but people like that evolve the human race, and they inspire people to go and push the boundaries and invent things and do things that they wouldn't normally do. And I see that as a very important part of life, is inspiring the young generation, inspiring my son to go out and be a man and you know, earn your living and do great things and do the best that you can for yourself, and not just for you, but for your family as well. I think that's important. And there are some great figures out there like Arnold Schwarzenegger that do that. You know, he came from nothing, he's worked his way up, and he's become this amazing global superstar that people love and adore. And there's millions of people that even now see Arnold and they go to the gym and they change their lives around. You know, overweight people that struggle with their mental health, see Arnold do what he's doing, get inspired, go in the gym and turn their lives around. So he's inspired me. I've inspired others, they've inspired others. It's a massive knock-on effect, and I'm aware of that, and that's why I push it very hard.
Yeah, that's interesting that you said that, because I was going to ask you who inspired you throughout your life. Was it Arnold?
100%. One of my first childhood memories was watching the Terminator 2 with Arnold Schwarzenegger walk into a bar butt naked and kick the shit out of about 20 outlaws and walk out with a, you know, a set of levers and a motorbike. And I just remember seeing that and being mesmerized, but also being inspired in a weird little way. I wanted to be Arnold Schwarzenegger. I wanted to be this guy with the big buff muscles, you know, who just, you know, just this amazing presence. And I saw that and it inspired me to work hard in my swimming before anything else. And then from the swimming, I went into bodybuilding, from bodybuilding to strongman. And all through that, my inspiration came from Arnold. It was just something that kept me pushing forward.
So do you think you're going to do the Hollywood move as well? Is that the next step?
Potentially. You know, I'm doing some, you know, dips and drabs in sort of filming and doing, I'd have some small parts. And then I keep going for the odd audition, but I'm very relaxed about it. You know, if it happens, it happens, but it's not like a fixation for me. But if it comes along, great, I'll do it. You know, I had a very, very small cameo in The Expendables where I end up beating the shit out of, nearly beating the shit out of Jason Statham and Sylvester Stallone. And, you know, that for me was an amazing experience, and that's something I'll never forget. And it does make me, you know, want to get in more into it, but I'm not fixated on it. You know, it's not a necessity for me. It's not something I have to do, but if it comes along, great.
But face on posters at cinemas would look quite good. I can see it.
It'd be nice, yeah.
Would you be the Beast or would you be Eddie Hall?
I'll be Eddie Hall, I think. I don't know.
And over the last 15 years, I mean, you've won a lot. What is the proudest win? Which one?
I think 100%, like, my childhood dream was to win the World's Strongest Man. I would say a close second would be lifting the 500 kilo deadlift, just because it's just one of, like, the first things that everyone saw as impossible. And it's something that I thought that I could do and prove a lot of people wrong and sort of, and again, inspire a lot of people, but also sort of cement my name in the history books in the strength world as the first person to ever deadlift 500 kilo. And I'm very proud of that. You know, it's something that literally all the strongman promoters said it was impossible. All the strongmen competitors said it was impossible. 99% of the fans said it was impossible. And I came and did it. So, you know, it's not impossible. And I proved it wasn't impossible.
So is there another challenge that you would like to tick off now and prove isn't impossible?
I mean, for me now, I'm sort of in limp mode. I've done what I needed to do in my career. You know, winning the World's Strongest Man and lifting the half ton deadlift were two big ticks for me. You know, I've been in business with Arnold Schwarzenegger. I've, you know, become friends with Arnold Schwarzenegger, and I've, you know, been on sets with big Hollywood stars. I think, you know, pretty much, if you're going to tick all the boxes, I've pretty much ticked them all. So for me now, it's just securing the future. You know, making sure I can retire and just have a nice life, and make sure my son has got a good future, and is, you know, make sure my son's not growing up to be a nice young man. And they're my goals at the minute, really. Just concentrate on family life.
Yeah. You know, well, that's what's nice at the age you are as well, being able to spend so much time with the family. Because, to be brutally honest, a lot of people in their mid-30s, me included, we have to go out and really graft to pay all the bills, but you've kind of done that. Do you need to work?
I hate saying it, but no, I don't. You know, I don't need to work. But like, what I'm doing now with my son is the most rewarding thing I've ever done in my life. When I was 16, I started work full-time. I was doing 80 hours a week in my job. I was working the doors at night time as well, so I was moonlighting. I was working over 8 hours a week in total, plus training 20 hours a week. And I did that for 10 years, 6-7 days a week, 10 years. And there were some days where I'd come home and I'd be head in hands crying because my life was just that shit. It was so hard. But I always had this dream that one day it would pay off. And, you know, and you win that title and you ride that wave on the back and you know, you set yourself up, and it came true. And then after the one in the Worlds, I did 2 years of endorsements, appearances, TV shows. Again, I was like away from home, like 3 months at a time, back for a day, away for 3 months, back for a day. And then COVID hit, and then I went straight into training for the boxing for 2 years, and that was like a 7 till midnight job again. So, you know, my son's 10 now, and I didn't know him up until about 6 months ago, I'll be brutally honest. Spending that time with my son, this last 6 months, has been the most rewarding thing for me. And it's like, that is my passion now. It's just family, wife, kids.
and it's a great place to be.
Yeah, that's, it's lovely to get that. I mean, it's a very special time as well when they're so young, because you'll always remember that. And when you look back through the years, and I always think that we can all do this, we can look back and go, I'd do that differently now, I wouldn't do that again. Is there anything in your career, or even before it, that you go, I wish I could just go back and redo that bit?
Yeah, of course, there's plenty of things I wish I could go back and do. But sat here now, I'm glad I didn't do them. I mean, there's some things in the Strongman world that I wish I'd have done, like the world record leg press. I wish I'd have brought the deadlift up even higher, because I know I was capable. But I'm going to sit here now and I think, if I'd have done another deadlift attempt and done 510, 520, 530, would I be sat here now in a wheelchair? You know, you just don't know what could happen and what you can do to yourself. So I can look in the mirror and be content. You know, I can look at myself and think, right, I have achieved what I wanted to achieve in life. And if you wanted to achieve, I just think it's a bit greedy to think, you know, I wish I could go back in time and do X, Y, and Z, because I'm happy, I'm content, and you know, I've left my mark.
To what extent, when you are in the strongman world, do you do things for a personal goal, or do you do things to kind of be lauded, right? So, I mean, is there a point where you're like, I shouldn't be doing that, it's not good for my health, but actually I quite like the glory?
I mean, the 500 kilo deadlift's a prime example, but people will be surprised as to why I did the deadlift, and it wasn't for glory, it wasn't for any legacy reasons, it was for money. And that might sound bad right saying it now, but let me explain a little bit. Is at the time in 2015, I just quit the job. I had a little bit of savings in my account, and you know, I had a mortgage, got bills, got people to support, and times were hard. And I thought to myself, I think in 2015 I pulled the world record deadlift for 463 kilo, and I thought it was so easy. I stood up with it like I was getting standing up out of this chair. It was so, so easy. And I thought to myself, if I could do something special with this, I could make a lot of money. And that money could help me win the World's Strongest Man, because, and again, I don't want to sound too arrogant, but to be the World's Strongest Man, you've got to be well off, because it costs so much money in food, in not working, in recovery, in gym memberships and proteins. It's like, literally, I was spending a minimum of £400 to £500 a week on my body. £350 of that was on food. So, you know, a lot of people don't even earn that a week. And I was spending like a full-time wage just on food. So you've got to be well off. So the deadlift was a setup clause for me. It was like, I did the deadlift in 2015, I went to the promoters and I said, like, how much would you pay for someone to come and pull 500 kilo next year? And they both looked at each other, burst out laughing, and name your figure. So we settled on a figure, shook the hand, came back next year. I did a few dodgy dealings, or I can't say too much, but put a little bet on myself, a few insurances. And, you know, that deadlift made a lot of money, and it...
How much?
I don't want to say how much.
But in the region of?
It was enough to get me to World's Strongest Man and make sure I had no financial worries, which was a massive factor. You know, I didn't have to worry about money, so that was a massive stress off. And the less stress you've got, the better you perform.
Yeah.
So that was the turn of the key to me winning World's Strongest Man, was doing the 500 kilo deadlift.
It's incredible to think how much money you spend on food. I know there's the documentary that went out earlier this year. There's this brilliant scene where Alex goes to the supermarket and they're like, oh, you're doing a big shop. And another woman said, oh, no, she'll be back here in a few days' time or whatever. I mean, you do have to go through a lot, which is a shame then that so many people who would love to do it, they just can't fund it, can they?
That's a massive problem with like the younger generation of athletes coming through. Is the sponsorship is very scarce, and I'm afraid unless you're winning competitions, nobody's interested. Like, if you come second place at UK Strongest Man, sorry to say, no one gives a shit. You come second place at World Strongest Man, sorry to say, no one gives a shit. So you have to be winning these competitions to get the sponsorships, but in order to win the competitions, you need the sponsorships. So it's like a horrible cycle of these athletes cannot progress.
because finances are holding them back.
But that must be where personality comes into it as well, because you have to have something extra to be given a break by these sponsors.
You have to come up with a dirty plan to put bets on yourself and do feats of strength, yeah.
And when you mentioned there, coming second doesn't even make any impact on you. What's it like as someone who's entering competitions and never winning? Because, you know, not many people win. Some people go for years and they do really well, top five, but as you say, no one pays attention to who comes second. What is that like? Is that, that must give a lot of people, you know, mental health issues as well.
It's hard, and, you know, I've been there myself. I've lost many a competitions in my life, and, you know, I've come second, third, fourth, way more times than I've come first. And I always say, well, I'll tell you what, I had a great conversation with a psychologist once, and I was having real problems with losing competitions, coming away and getting great depression and feeling shit and feeling like giving up. But then the psychologist sort of weighed it all up for me and sort of said, like, right, what if I told you you were only 12 losses away from winning the World's Strongest Man? And then it just went ding. I was just like, fucking hell, completely right. Like, you've got to go through those losses. You've got to go through those failures to make you learn your mistakes, go back, rebuild, and come back stronger. So now I see losses, I see failures as lessons. You don't lose in life. You either win or you learn. And I think that's a great way to look at it. Because if you see it as a loss, that's when you start getting the mental health problems and you start, you know, doubting yourself and thinking you're not good enough. So yeah, you either win or you learn. That's a good motto I like to say to people.
Yeah, no, I think it's important to have that, to kind of stay positive, because otherwise, when you are at a stage where you're thinking I might give up, you've also then got to think, what are you gonna do? Did you ever have a stage where you had to consider your options? Did you have a plan B?
There was never a plan B. I think, I said it on the documentary in 2015, two years before on the World's Strongest Man. I was either gonna win it or I was gonna be dead. There was only two options for me. There was no plan B. So, you know, if I hadn't won it in 2017, I probably would have tried again and again and again. Probably would have got to about 50 stone and would have died of a heart attack. So, you've gotta, people say you've gotta draw the line somewhere, but there was no line drawing for me. You know, I had to win that title. It was like a life necessity.
Yeah. And in terms of health, how is your health? Because for a lot of people, as you say, they get carried away and they put themselves in a pretty dangerous situation.
Yeah, I mean, health-wise, I mean, when I won the World's Strongest Man, I was 32 stone.
So what are you now?
158 kilos. So I'm at about 20. About 25 stone,
right.
Something like that. So yeah, I mean, being 32 stone, 433 pounds, 196 kilos, and I remember going to the. I had loads of doctors and specialists around me, and I remember going to my normal doctor, my regular doctor. We're doing blood tests, and my liver markers are through the roof, my kidney markers are through the roof, my hemoglobin, my blood's like sludge. You know, I'm 32 stone, I'm getting out of breath, walking up the stairs, and this guy's looking me up and down, and he's like, you are literally, you write it down on paper, like your body weight, your BMI, your body fat percentage. He's like, you are statistically one of the most highest risk people in the whole country to die of a heart attack and a stroke, right here, right now in that chair. And I was just like, fucking hell. And he was right, he was completely right. And I think that's the risk you've got to take to be, you know, the world's strongest man. Is you've got to push those boundaries. You've got to, sometimes, you know, to go up against a giant, you've got to be a giant. And that's how I saw it. You know, you want to be a 500 pound man, you've got to be 500 pounds. So pushing the boundaries is important. And then, but there's also having the brains to, after you've won, after you've achieved what you've got to do, is bringing it down, scaling it back, taking that pressure off your heart and your kidneys and livers and everything else, and adding longevity to your life. And that's what I did.
Yeah, it's amazing really what you've done. Do you ever look back and think, if you had stuck with swimming, where you might be now, what you'd have looked like?
Jesus.
Imagine.
I mean, when I was, I won my first national championships when I was 10 years old. And I had a six pack, I had biceps, I had shoulders. I was stacked. I was a 10 stone kid with abs and a chest. And for me, that's like, I did that up until I was 13. I was on the world class potential squad. So I was on the junior Olympic team. And yeah, being that scale of an athlete where you're in the water training 20 hours a week, it's amazing to think like what you can do at that age and what you could have done, like where could that progress? And I've had pals from my swimming days that have gone on and won gold medals. And it does make me think, what if I'd have stuck to it? But then I also think those people have won gold medals and then gone back to normal jobs. And that happens quite a lot, you know? You've got to pick the right avenue. And in a way, I'm hella glad that I did sort of lose interest in the swimming and pick the strongman path, because who knows, maybe the personality would have shown through, but I just think winning a gold medal in swimming wouldn't have, you know, I wouldn't be saying now talking to you guys. Yeah. You know, the path has its ways.
Yeah. And what other sports, what other fitness do you do apart from just lifting weights? I've seen that you've got kind of a swimming setup as well. So you still do, I mean, can I say, the swimming that you do at home, have you seen it? Like, it's like on a bungee and swimming against a tiger. I mean, that looks hardcore. what else do you do?
I mean, in terms of exercise, you know, I still do bits of boxing. I love to swim. I try and swim once a week. And one of the best things I did, and in a way, the boxing fight, yes, I lost the fight, but there's so many positives to come out of that. And one of them was my health. You know, it really taught me to scale back my food, my diet, and also daily routine and exercise. It got me back into something. And one of the best things I did was get this guy here. And every morning, just getting up and going for a 10, 15 minute walk, and sometimes in the evening, well, and that just, it sorts your head out. It keeps the fat off. And I always say to people now, people say to me, like, how do you lose weight? I'm like, go for a fucking walk. It's the easiest, 10 minutes, and it's the best thing you can do for your head. 10 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes in the evening, and you'll burn 1,000 calories doing that, you know? So that's one of the best bits of advice I can give anyone out there, is get a dog.
That's so true. And during COVID, most of the country, I would be surprised if there are people here that didn't, most of the country took up running and discovered that's good for their head. Can I ask, is that something that you would do?
I have run, yeah, I've done running, but I must admit it destroys my knees and I dislocated my hip in 2017, so I've got a bit of a hip problem. So yeah, I don't like to run because I end up walking like a granddad for a week after.
Yeah, so, fair enough.
Good fast walk is enough.
Right, let's talk about the fight earlier this year, if that's all right. This was set to be the biggest fight ever in Dubai, you versus the mountain. Why did you feel you needed to do this?
Well, I mean, at the time, you got to remember that the COVID hit and obviously the start of 2020, and there was a big question mark as to what I'm going to do for my job. You know, all TV work froze up. Pretty much, well, the world was locked down, so the social media dropped. You know, it was a big question mark of income for me. So, and then this contract landed on under my nose to fight Thor for a big amount of money, and I was like, fucking hell, how can I turn this down at this time? So signed it, and it gave me a purpose to get back into training and obviously earn some good cash as well. So that's why I took it up, really. It was the right time and the right place.
Possibly not you, maybe the family, were they like, do you not think it's a bit dangerous to go and do something like that? Were they a bit scared?
Of course, yeah, but I think my wife knew. She wasn't going to talk me out of it, so it was sport. You know? Yeah. So it was just getting in and doing business.
And we saw during the training, there was one stage actually when you tore your bicep. I mean, it was like totally gutting because that set things back.
100%, you know, I mean, we're talking, I think I was 8 weeks out from the fight, I tore my bicep, and then they rescheduled the fight for 5 months later. So tearing the bicep was a massive setback because not only did I only have one arm, I had to change my stance. So for, I think, 16 months, I've been fighting orthodox, which is right-handed. And then when I tore my bicep, I had to change to southpaw. So I had to change to a left-handed fighter. And then, obviously, for 6 months, I could only train with one arm. So I had to go into the fight with Thor with one arm, which, in all honesty, like, people think I'm making an excuse. I'm not. I genuinely thought I was going to walk in there and knock him out with one arm, but it didn't happen. But I'm glad, you know, I couldn't have delayed it anymore. The fighters wouldn't let me delay it. It was just because it got delayed the first time. They went again. So I there was a lot of pressure on me to do it. So I went in there, fought Thor with one arm. And, you know, you lose. But again, like, off the back of that, it's helped me move on a lot. You know, there's a lot of shit between me and Thor that went on. It was nice to punch the guy in the face and just have it out and just, like, right, draw a line on it and move on. And it's been it's been a really good thing for me, really. So yeah, it was a good move in general.
Yeah, and we will talk more about it. Actually, you did well, by the way. It's not like you were out. You went right to the end, and then we had to wait and see who won. When you went and got the operation on your arm, how long did the doctor say you needed to kind of rest and recover and recuperate?
So when you reattach a muscle to a bone, you're not allowed to use it for 8 weeks.
And how long did you take off?
2. So I was back swimming after 2 weeks. Very, I must admit, very gentle. And I would say it was 3 months after the surgery until I could actually pick a weight up and start moving it. But he said to me, the surgeon said, you know, he's worked with boxers before, you cannot throw a punch with that arm for 12 months. So I was just like, well, fuck, I've got to fight in 5 months. And he's like, well, you can fight, but you can't use your left arm. So, but at least I had it to sort of throw the odd jab, you know, a little bit of an arsenal. But yeah, it was a massive hindrance to me.
And I can imagine that maybe you're not the best patient. Are you someone that's quite good at just sitting? They say, don't do any exercise today. Are you that person?
I have to get up and do something. You know, I think I had the surgery. I blew my bicep off on the Monday. I had it reattached on the Thursday. And I was back in the gym on Monday doing leg stuff. So, you know, there was no time off. It was like straight back in.
Can I ask you, how would you feel if someone said, you actually can't do anything for a week? Would that put you in a dark place?
No, I think, if it was a week, it'd be okay. If it was a month, it would start to set in. If it was more than a month, yeah, I'd start to struggle.
What is it that you get out of doing stuff like that puts you in the good place?
I mean, training for me is, it's my outlet, it's my void filler. And when I was 13 and I was chucked off the swimming squad, so I wasn't allowed to swim anymore, I stopped training and depression and anxiety crept in very, very quickly. And I believe it was because of, you know, not exercising, not venting and not getting my frustration out, not getting my anger out, that it all pent up and I ended up being prescribed Prozac and psychiatrist. I was expelled from school. No end of problems. And then it was about 14, 15, I started, my mum and dad said, you know, you're expelled from school, you're not sitting at home all day, go to the fucking gym. So I went to the gym and that's when it started to clear up. Every time I went to the gym, I came out and I felt better. You know, I got a sense of euphoria, I got a sense of self-worth. And that's when I realized, I guess, is that exercise is my key. Without exercise, I'm just gonna implode. So, and that's been the key for the rest of my life, I think. You know, like Arnie says, it's something you're gonna do till he dies. You know, it's sort of like, you get up and have breakfast, I'll get up and train. Yeah. That's literally my method.
Yeah, and going back to the fight, when you're in Dubai, and Max, your boy, he was there as well. How was it for you, knowing that he was watching this? I mean, your eyes were cut and everything. How did that make you feel afterwards, knowing that he had been watching that?
Make me feel proud. You know, it's, I always think with the younger generation, you've got to teach your kids how to act. And I think I acted right. You know, it's how you react to a loss. You can cry and bitch and you can blame the other person and you can say they cheated like Thor did at Worlds. Or you can be a man and you can take it on the chin and you can say, I've lost that, try to be honest, let's move on. And I think that's important. It's learning how to lose and be gracious about it, you know, and learn from it and move on. I mean, and that's an important thing. And it's like I say, you either win or you learn in life. And I think, you know, don't get me wrong, the loss was hard, but I took it on the chin and I moved on.
How long does it take to kind of go, right, let's move on, let's look at the positive. How many hours or days are you livid?
I don't know, I'd say within a couple of weeks, you have this massive high. It was a great thrill getting in the ring and doing business, you know, the huge spend. I think it's over 50 million people watched that fight. Yeah. And that's huge. That's as big as, you know, Floyd Mayweather or Tyson Fury fight, 50 million. And I suppose that massive high was great. And then obviously it's the back down to the, you're back home and you're walking your dog and you're not wiping my son's arse anymore, but you know, you're doing normal things again. And I think that, again, it's tough. And then you've got to find your purpose again. And I found it in my family, so.
Rematch, what are the chances?
I don't think there'll be a rematch. He doesn't want one. And to be honest, the quality time I'm spending with my family now, I don't want to go back, I don't want to lose that anymore. You know, I'm reconnecting with my wife, I'm spending some amazing hours and training my son up. And that's been one of the most beautiful things I've experienced so far in my life. And I want to continue it. And the thought of going back to training 12 hours a day, just to make him some money, I'm not interested. Like, I'm fine.
Okay. In terms of the brand as well, obviously it is huge. Do you have plans to keep growing that? Is there anything that you want to do?
I mean, yeah, the brand's always growing, I suppose. I'm doing lots of social media stuff. I've got lots of TV shows sort of in the works. So yeah, I'm not stressed about it. I'm just going with the flow and just enjoying myself.
I love how positive you are. Have you just always been like that?
You have to be.
Yeah.
You have to be positive. You have to have a good outlook. And if you don't, as I say, you start self-doubting yourself and thinking horrible thoughts. And you've got to, you know, whatever you do in life, you've got to grab it two hands and enjoy it, or try to enjoy it at least.
Yeah. So I suppose we need to give some advice out there. If anyone wants to get into strongman, how should they go about it? What is the correct way to get there and to climb the ladder?
So a strongman for me would be, you know, build the basics first, get to the gym, get your squat, bench and deadlift right up there, build this, you know, the accessory muscles. And then just start, once you've done a few years of building the basics, start testing the waters, enter some local competitions, see how you do. And then build up from there. Obviously you qualify for your nationals, your regionals, and just keep going and going and going. I think, you know, I'm quite lucky where I did it quite right. You know, I trained from age 15 up until I was 19. So I did a good 4 or 5 years of training before I even entered a strongman competition. And I was strong. Like, when I was 19, I was squatting 300 kilo, benching with a shirt. I was benching 280, deadlifting like 380 kilo. And this was at 19 years of age. I was a freak. But it was like that 4 or 5 years of just obsessive lifting in the gym that put me in that position. And then, you know, you become the strongest guy in the gym, and then you look on the internet, on YouTube and stuff, and it's like you're watching World's Strongest Men train, and you're like, I can fucking do that. You know, and then you turn into competition and you fucking can't. So so you've just got to build the basics and get into it.
And when you do stuff like this, how lonely is it when you're out there? I mean, I presume having family and good support networks really important. Is it a friendly place? I mean, what do you experience?
Strongman is quite a lonely sport. You know, when you're in the gym, you a lot of times you're training on your own. You're training for 4 or 5 hours a night. And of course, you know, all day you're eating and sleeping, so wife and kids are at work or school, so you're on your own there, you're training on your own, you're coming back very late, you're eating, I'm getting in my hyperbaric chamber till midnight, so my wife's going to bed before me. So it's a very lonely place. But I feel like having that support network behind you, like knowing that my wife's there, looking after the kids, keeping the house right, looking, you know, cleaning my clothes, doing my food, it's a great feeling knowing that you've got a support network and that they're gonna be there at the end of it. You know, I've got a really supportive family in that way, whereas, you know, I did 10 years of literally 100 hours a week of, you know, strongman. And I'd be lucky if I spent an hour or 2 hours a week with my wife and kids, but they put up with it and they're still here. And that's what kept me going.
Yeah. And it's really important. I love what you said earlier about how giving up was never an option. But for many people, they just don't know if they'll ever achieve that goal. Is that because they're not believing in themselves enough? I mean, should you have a goal and not stop till you get there? Or do you have to be more realistic?
Well, I mean, having goals is very, very important in life. And of course, being realistic is a big question mark. I mean, when I said when I was 19, I was going to win the World's Strongest Man. And everybody I told laughed at me, like, yeah. You know, I'd be working the doors downtown. Oh, what are you doing? Oh, I'm doing strongman contest. Oh, what's she got? I'm going to win the World's Strongest Man. Oh, good luck, mate. Are you being serious? Good luck. And I suppose you have, like, to many people, that is an unrealistic goal. But for me, it was achievable. You know, it wasn't impossible. Everything's possible. And I think putting pressure on yourself is also a very good tool. Well, I found it a very good tool, is putting pressure on yourself. So being very vocal, you know, I'm going to be the world's strongest man. I'm going to be the first one to lift half a ton. And with putting that pressure on yourself, you are making yourself tune in and train for it and do the things that you've got to do, you know. So if I say I'm going to win the world's strongest man and turn up and come second, at least I can sit there and say, well, gave it everything I got. You know, I didn't miss a training session, I didn't miss a meal, I didn't miss a physio session. I couldn't stand there and say, well, I missed a training session 6 weeks ago and that's why I lost. I couldn't say that because I gave it everything I got. And I did that because I put pressure on myself. And I think it's the great old saying that pressure creates diamonds. And that's why I love that saying, because I put all that pressure on myself and you get the best out of yourself. So I think even if you write it down on a piece of paper, even if you tell a friend, you tell your mum, your dad, your brother, your sister, your wife, your husband, whatever. I think if you just say that out loud, it puts pressure and then it makes you commit. And I think commitment, it's being accountable almost. It's creating that accountability for yourself. And I think that's very, very important in life.
Yeah, no, I agree. And it's incredible to see how many people that you have inspired as well. When we all look back in years to come, and we're all talking about Eddie Hall, how would you like everyone to remember you? What would you like them to remember?
Oh, well, world's strongest man, first man to deadlift half a ton, and a loving family man. Those three things is all I want. You know, I'd be happy with that.
Yeah. And what I find brilliant is the fact that you're 34 and you have got so much more to do. There's no plans at the moment, just seeing what happens.
I'm very chill. I've got some TV channels wanting to do various different ideas with, you know, Eddie Eats America. Eddie makes, you know, crushes things with his tank. Eddie makes motorbikes. There's so many different ideas floating around. And there's a few TV shows scheduled for next year. So that's in the pipe work. Obviously the acting side, I've been doing acting lessons and just going to the odd audition, but again, very relaxed. Spending time with my family, training my son up, that's a very important thing for me. Growing the brand, you know, social media, I'm enjoying doing that, like Facebook and YouTube, that's a good income as well. So, you know, plenty to keep me busy.
Yeah.
And I'm winding down, you know, I'm 34, I feel a bit. I always said when I was younger, I want to be retired by 30. And I'm 34 now and I'm still going. But I'm enjoying myself and I think I'm still going because I enjoy being active. You know, I enjoy getting up every day and doing a little task, you know, going and making a video or training with my son or, you know, going to a competition and just watching on and refereeing it or something. You know, just there's little things in life that keep you active and keep your mind good.
Yeah, and you still live in the same area as well. I mean, how important is it to be there, to be like local to where you come from?
It's massively important. I think community is something I heavily rely on. You know, even if it's little things like filling up my truck at the petrol station or my tank, and you know, the same person serving me at the petrol station. Little things like that, going to the shop every day with my son before training and going to get a drink and a scratch card and a chocolate bar or whatever. Mum and dad are close by, you know, family are close by. Got a few select friends that are close by. I think, you know, that's something that if I moved away, I'd miss heavily, you know. So I've got no interest of sort of moving out to America or moving out to the coast or London or anything like that. I'm happy where I am. I've got a great community around me that I love and enjoy. And things are put, you know, I still live, I bought my first house when I was 18 years of age.
And I lived up and lived in that up until I was 29. And then I bought my second house on the same street. But when we were kids, we used to call, I used to live on a council estate where I bought my first house. And then up the top end of the street is what we used to call the snob end. And that's where I live now. But it's quite nice to live on the same street that I bought my first house on. You know, it's quite, and seeing the same people, people that grew up with in school, just bumping into, you know, driving down the road, oh, there's Carl from high school, or, you know, there's Sarah, going to the shop, and it's the same, you know, it's nice. I do enjoy living around the same area.
One of the things I've taken away from what you said there is that you go and buy scratch cards.
It's, yeah.
Have you won?
No, but the most I've ever won is like 10 quid. But it's a nice bit of fun. You only get a £1 scratch card. But every day before training, there's a little treat for me son. We'll go and buy a Lucozade, a chocolate bar, and a scratch card. And every time on the drive back, my son will go, I've won £10,000. And I'm like, no, I haven't. So yeah, it's a nice little bit of fun for me and my son every day.
Yeah, no, it's nice to have these lovely memories as well. And your daughter as well, do you see her much too?
Layla lives not far away. She lives with her mum, so I see her now and again.
Okay, fine. Before we go, I wonder if there is anyone here with a question. We might have time for maybe one or two, if anyone would like to ask one before I ask any more. We've got a few hands. Is there someone with a microphone? Or shall I come and do it? They're coming over here. Sorry, I surprised you with that. I just thought, since there's so many people, we should ask someone if they've got a question. We've got over here. You're gonna come on. You can walk faster than that. Yes, there we go. Down here, come, keep coming forward, keep coming forward. And there, right beside you, go. Oh, we didn't need the microphone. Okay. No, there's tech. This is so slick.
Hi, Eddie.
Hi.
Nice to speak to you. Who is your most favourite strongman of all time? Including yourself.
Good question.
So my most favourite strongman of all time has got to be Brian Shaw. Become a very good friend of mine. And when I started competing in strongman, Brian was the top of the game. I started competing in 2012, and I think Brian first won in 2010. So he was someone that, you know, straight away I looked up to. And I've got to be honest, the first time I competed at World's Strongest Man in 2012, me and Brian didn't see eye to eye. You know, I think we just had a completely different persona. I think it was like 2015 when I got very serious. That's when I quit my job. In 2015, I got very serious. And I thought, I need to learn from the best. So I latched onto Brian. Okay, Brian, you know, befriended him, became his friend. And learning from Brian, you know, learning his ways, learning what he does at competition, learning what he eats, how he trains, how he relaxes, his recovery. And for me, Brian is probably the one and only strongman that's helped me, you know, talk to me, showed me the ropes, told me how he recovers, his recovery, his nutrition, everything. And Brian's probably the reason why, you know, I went on to win the World's Strongest Man. He's become a very dear, close friend. And even, you know, I was texting Brian yesterday and he sent me a message saying, if you can reply in between shoveling food in your face, it'd be nice if you give me a call. So I'm going to talk to him on Monday. But yeah, we keep in touch quite regularly. But Brian, he was an inspiration for me. He was a role model. You know, great, great family man, amazing sportsman, and an even better friend.
Did you get starstruck when you started meeting all the strong men that you'd been watching on the telly?
I guess when you first walk onto that World's Strongest Man scene, you do get a little bit sort of taken back because you see them all on TV and they've all got this persona of, you know, all you see is them growling and grunting and pulling planes and lifting out the stones. And then when you actually meet them, they're just like you and me, you know, they've got families and, you know, they have to go out and eat and drink and whatever else. So you quickly learn that these are normal, nice people.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, are you ready for another question? Who have we got? Well, let's go in the middle. There's someone standing very tall. Can you bring the mic over again in the middle, please? There we go. Right. Keep going. There's a lady with blonde hair. There we go. Hi, Eddie.
This is more of a training-based question. What's your favourite exercise or routine or superset that it doesn't matter what else is going on, but that's the one that you always look forward to in your week, or you love the way that it feels, the pump or the burn or the DOMS after?
Oh, geez. I must admit, like, training for me is really dimmed down, but you'll be surprised, actually, it's not the deadlift. It is actually shoulders. I love just grabbing a set of dumbbells, getting it to my shoulder, and just pumping out as many reps as I can. Just literally like 60% of my max, and just keep going. I usually do about 40 to 50 reps, and it's the best feeling in the world. You get this huge pump in your shoulder, you feel great, you know, you're out of breath, and it's a real good stress reliever. And I get my son to do it once a week as well, and he loves it. So I think just like a good hand wrap on your shoulders now and again, so it's one of my favourites.
What weight are you lifting?
I think yesterday, Friday, Thursday, I did 40 kilo dumbbells for 50 reps.
And there's a video on your Instagram, have you seen it, where you've actually got three people lifting the weight for each hand as well. This would be a problem, I imagine.
Yeah, that was obviously when I was strong. But yeah, I mean, like shoulder pressing 100 kilo dumbbells to get 100 kilos up onto one side is, you know, that's a hell of a lift for one person. You know, usually for me to get 100 kilo dumbbell to there, I used to get two people to lift it up, put it on my shoulder, and then I do my set. So that's one of the problems I've had over the years is finding people to help lift weights for me, to get into place, people to spot me. That's been a real big problem over the years.
I do that with 10. It's actually no problem at all for me. Let's get a fella now to mix things up. There on the end, right in front of you. Thank you. Oh, no. Right. Shout it. Go on.
What's crack? Nice seeing you. Would you ever think of expanding the brand in the essence of taking the strongman under your wing?
Say that again, mate, sorry.
Would you ever think of expanding the essence of your legacy and brand to taking someone as a competitor under your wing?
Sponsor somebody?
Or a mentor or something?
Like mentor or training.
Mentor. I mean...
Because that's what you're saying, it's difficult for people to come through. You could actually mentor.
So, we've got a business in place called Official Strongman, and that's like the qualifying process. Because when I started Strongman, there was no qualifying process to the World's Strongest Man. You just basically win UK Strongest Man or Britain's Strongest Man, and you get an invite. Now there's a qualifying process in place called Official Strongman, and you enter that. You enter, you know, your regionals, your nationals, and then you compete at the Worlds. So there's a qualifying process in place, and I sort of created that along with Giants Live. And then in terms of like mentoring somebody, that's going to be through the website as well. But I do actually sponsor a few athletes myself. One of them, I a bit weird, but I sponsor a boxer as well. There's a lad that I started to train with who's a 7'1" boxer who's only 19. I started sponsoring him, and I think he's going to go a long way. So, you know, I'm always on the lookout for talent, and if I see something that I think is going to go a long way, I will grab it with two hands and give them the opportunities. I must say though, that there is people that I've given opportunities to, and they piss it over the wall, and it happens more than you think, you know. So you've got to be very select of who I sort of do mentor.
Okay, thank you for your questions, all of you. Thank you. It's been really nice to chat to you. I hope you've enjoyed listening and that you've learned something about Eddie as well. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for the Beast, Eddie Hall!
Thanks, ladies and gentlemen. Hope you all have a good weekend. Thank you.
Bring the action.